good evening, everybody. My name is Carl Slaap. I'm a watchmaker here in the Netherlands. And we get many, many questions from hobby watchmakers or people who want to become a professional watchmaker. If we have some advice on the workshop, on the layout, how to start a workshop, things to take into account. And I've got that question so many times here in the workshop, but on social media especially. I thought, why not make a small clip with the simple basics, what to think about when you want to start your own workshop. And well, we have a professional workshop here, and this is for us very nice, the best setup for us. But even if your workshop or your workbench is in a bedroom or in a closet or way up in the attic, there are some basic rules you have to take into account. And I'd like to elaborate on that a bit more today. So cheers, and tips for workshop layout. Well, first things first. Watchmakers wear a white coat, and that is not because of we really want to be a doctor. The white coat is white because small parts can fly away, join the Swiss space program, and they're easy to pick up from your white coat. But most important, it is a dust cover. They keep the fibers from your clothing on the inside, so they're not going to spread around or end up in your movement, in your work. So the white coat is preventing the fibers and dust from your clothing to enter in the workshop. That's why all watchmakers wear white dust coats. I think very important. Second thing is the loop, and I think I'm going to tell you a bit more about them later on. The two basic loops we use, I'm going to show you in a moment that we hardly ever use these loops because we all work with, if you see here, the microscopes. But if you want to use loop, we have a loop one. This one is from ASCO, and that is number one, is a real intense magnifying loop. So that's just for control, for checking pivots, checking your jewels, stuff like that. So you're not actually using day in, day out loop number one, only if you want to look at it real close. The normal magnification you use is a loop 2.5. This one is from Petit Pierre. Lovely loop. And that's your normal working loop. Important tip. If you wear a loop, we have one here with the rim on it. If you wear a loop, keep both of your eyes open. If you start squinting, you probably will get a headache. And some of the students here get seasick if they start squinting like that, so please don't. Keep both eyes open, and trust me, your brain will switch over to this eye by itself. Trust me on this one. If you keep both eyes open, your brain will switch. And that makes it so much easier. So please, try this tip. All our students immediately work like that. And if you start squinting, it's really hard not to do that anymore. So from day one, please try that. It is very common that the loops will fog off. There is fog on the lens. Simple trick. Drill tiny holes, 1, 2, in the loop, and there will be no fog. And even you see the Petit Pierre here, they even have the louvers in there, so there is some ventilation, and through the ventilation there will be no fog. So simple, drill 2 holes, 1 there, 1 there, and the fog will lift. So that's the basic loops you use. The quality in a loop, you can see if the edges are still very crisp and good to look at, that is when you have a quality loop. If the edges of the loop, the sides, start to deform, well, then you have got a less quality loop. So I hope that's helpful. Then, very important for watchmaking, besides the watchmaker fuel, very important are finger cots. You can call them finger condoms, and they are important. If you lick your fingers, you will taste some acid or some salt. And those acids and salt will etch the metal in your movement. You will leave a fingerprint, but the fingerprint will stay there because it's etching in the metal. So that's why I am right-handed. So on the left hand, we all use 3 finger cots. They are latex. Only the 3, because your pink and ring finger you use to stabilize your hand, and then it's easy to manipulate a watch movement or whatever you're working on. You only use finger cots, well, I'm right-handed, on your left hand, because on your right hand you're only touching the tools. So I see some watchmakers using finger cots on their right hand as well, but it's really not necessary, because you're not touching the movement with your right hand. So usually, again, it's just a suggestion, but this is the way we work. Usually just the finger cots on your left hand when you're right-handed, so you can manipulate and touch the watch movement. And with the right hand, you are holding the tools. So, finger cots. Widely available at chemists for a really good price. So, try that one. It's a good tip. Another tip. Again, I hope this is useful. And please leave comments so we can use them in other videos and try well, whatever you like to hear or know a bit more about. Please let me know in the comments, and please let me know what you think of these clips. Next thing is the color of your worktop. You probably will see it's usually a greenish, mint green top, and it's very simple. The green color is the color that the human eye sees the best contrast. So tiny parts you see immediately on a light green surface, and it is not straining for the eye. So the green surface is relatively calm for the eye. You don't have to strain your eyes for the green surface. So even if you're working on a bureau or a chest of drawers or whatever, if you got a square, well, a bit like this, a watchmaker is working on a tiny space. So if you just have the square a bit greenish, trust me, you your eyes will, it's pleasant for the eyes, it's not straining, and you see good contrast. So try it just a bit, and it's really going to help you with that. Again, I hope that's useful. Again, we get these questions so often that maybe for you guys, well, we know this already. Well, good for you. But we get these questions so often that even the simpler stuff of starting in your workshop, I'd like to just tell you about these topics. So even though it may be simple, it's worthwhile just to show you a bit more. The normal bench. Again, these came from Rolex, but if you got just a top to work on, no problem whatsoever. Again, I don't believe in planks above it, because all the dust will gather there. So if you got all your parts and your machines and your tools and your stuff on planks just above your workspace, all the dust will come down. Most professional workshops are pressurized. So there's a pressure in there, so no dust can enter the workshop. Dust is a real big problem in watchmaking. That's why the white coat, and that's why there aren't any planks above your workspace. Again, I really do understand why you want to have some planks with the parts, the machines, the tools, but keep them in drawers like this, or a chest of drawers next to it. If they are in a drawer, they are protected. You can find your stuff just by using a drawer, and they don't gather dust. That's the most important. It sounds really logical, but we get these questions so often that I think it's nice just to tackle the topic. And then, again, dust. You can use a kitchen towel, paper towel, whatever, but make sure it doesn't leave any fibers. That is important. A fiber is just as bad as the dust. Just simple cleaning liquid, nothing fancy, nothing too special, but slightly a degreaser, just get the grease off. Maybe some oil on your workbench. And then, it sounds logical, but still, I think it's a good idea just to tell you everything we do and how we do it. Simple, start at the top while cleaning. We all clean the lamp first and then the workbench. Again, dust will gather. And we do this every single day. Start high and work your way down in simply cleaning your workspace. And that's why we don't have a lot of stuff on your workbench, because if a watch part flies away or does anything, it's so much easier to find it if you got a clean desk. So keep that in mind. While talking at it, another thing, a very common mistake, there are two things. When we've got students here, and we get quite a few of them, when they start disassembling the watch, they always start here on the workbench. But during disassembly, all the parts come off, and every single time with new students, they end up just about working here on the movement, very close to the edge. And if they're less experienced, well, some part can drop. And if you're close to the edge, it will drop immediately on the floor. But if you keep on working like here, you've got all the space around you, and it's so much easier just doing this disassembly here instead of here. Sounds logical, it is, but take it, just take the information in and do whatever you think is the best way for you to work on it. Another very important thing with new students here, and I can hear it within 3 minutes. I can pick them out one by one within 3 minutes. If they're working on a watch movement and it's very intense and they're doing their best or solve problems or working on tiny parts, the pivots or working on the hairspring, I can hear them immediately from quite a distance because they're breathing in their chest really small breaths. And because it's intense and they're working on it. And when you do that for some time, say half an hour, when you're really fiddling about, you'll tremble because less oxygen is entering your lungs and your blood. So whenever I hear it, I say, please have a couple of good breaths, breathe from your stomach instead of your chest. And it makes life so much easier. Control your breath and your hands, and it will be so much easier. You stay focused longer, and try to see that how that works when you are working on a watch movement. Try to control your breath. It is really helpful. And then I told you earlier about the loops and that we really not using them too much here in the workshop. And I will tell you why. I was one of the first, well, definitely the first in the Netherlands, to work with the microscope. I used to be in IT long time ago, and then I saw in a production plant they used microscopes for assembling the SMDs, the surface mounted devices, tiny parts, tiny pieces, and assembling was done under a microscope. And they are pretty similar size as watch parts. So I started working on a microscope long time ago, and well, definitely the first in the Netherlands. We all, watchmakers always used microscopes for quality control, or to check the pivots, or so microscopes were already there always for a long time. But these microscopes on a boom, on an arm, and working on them was something else. And I'll show you why there really wasn't a choice for me for using the microscope. Because usually for watchmakers, this is the common position, working like this. And I worked for that for years. And all the time, these muscles, well, I needed a massage just about every week because these muscles were strained. I got neck problems because I was sitting like this for many hours a day. It was just not working for me. Again, if this is working for you and you're working like this for years, no problem. I just want to explain an alternative and why it was for me the best option. But then again, the options I show during these clips might not be the best solution for you. I just want to show an alternative so you yourself can make the decision if you're going to work like that or maybe not. Whatever floats your boat, whatever flicks your switch. But this position wasn't it for me. And the main reason, well, with a microscope you can see everything so much better, and I think you get a better quality of work. But the main reason is this. With a microscope, I sit like this, and I'll work like this. My elbows are resting on the top, on the workbench, but you can see my back is straight, and when I'm working like this, there is no strain on the muscles in my neck. I can sit like this for weeks on end, no problem whatsoever. So the advantage of using with a microscope, especially this one, if you don't use it, leave it like that, is the posture, the position for your back. And it makes a world of difference for me. But then again, if you are used working like this and you've got no problem with it, excellent, no problem. For me, this was a lifesaver and really, really important for me. Well, we've got the worktops, how to clean it. We've got the microscopes, we've got the loops, and how to prevent them from fogging up. We've got the finger cuts, how to use it. If there are any questions for how to work as a watchmaker, please let me know. And there is so much more to tell you about the workshop. And well, maybe one more thing is the floor. Maybe it's not wise if you're not too experienced, if you got a rug lying here, because you'll never find the parts anywhere. So if you got your floor light and without any creases or cracks where small parts always like a magnet go in there, it is wise to have a light floor with no cracks in it. Or you can start working in a bathtub with the shower curtain all around you and with the plug in there, so you always know all the parts that fly away, well, they're in the drain. So I think it's a good tip. Have everything clean. No planks above the worktop, because they will gather dust. And dust, especially when you use a microscope, you see it immediately, is going to prevent an excellent end result. That's why the white coat. Worktop, if you've got a choice, mint green is excellent, but then again, if it's wood or white or whatever you feel like it, and that gives you the best result, well, I just want to give an alternative, and I want to explain why we made some decisions and why that is working for us. So that's it for me for tonight. Just a couple of basic things. How to start your workshop, what easy things you can do to get a better end result, like make sure the dust is as less as possible. That is, and try to keep your breathing a bit lower, and trust me, it will start or lessen the trembling, and it gives you so much more focus, So I hope these small suggestions are helpful. And again, my name is Kalle Slaap. I'm a watchmaker here in the Netherlands. We've been doing the live streams for over 3.5 years now on Twitch, on YouTube, and on Facebook. Well, please like our YouTube channel. There's plenty of more watchmaking stuff coming there. And I really hope you enjoy them. Leave your comments underneath this clip. And if you got suggestions, yeah, please share them with us. And we hope we can answer all your questions. Again, thank you so much for watching, and hope to see you soon. Cheers, see ya, bye bye.